I don't have too many. I don't really have any announcements today, other than to thank Anna for being here, thank Joe for being here, thank everybody who's watching. And I also would like to invite everyone to tune in on Facebook and on the stream on Thursday nights at 7 for a Bible study. This week, I believe we will talk a little bit about prayer, and we'll talk about sin in preparation for talking about the atonement, how Jesus solves the problem of sin. Gathering prayer.
And speaking of prayer, join me in the gathering prayer. Glorious, loving Father, by thy mighty resurrection of your Son, you overcame the old order of sin and death to make all things new in him. Grant that we who celebrate with joy Christ rising from the dead may be raised from the death of sin and into the life of righteousness through him who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Let the holy roar of God resound. Watch the waters part before us now. Come and see what God has done for us. Tell the world of his great love. Our God is the God who saves. Our God is the God who saves.
Both our call to confession and our assurance of pardon this week come from the fifth chapter of Paul's letter to the Romans. God demonstrates his own love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Please join me in the prayer of confession. Merciful Almighty Father, through the death and resurrection of Jesus, you offer us the opportunity to live a new kind of life now, life lived in the light of Jesus. But we often choose to lurk in the shadows. You offer us transformation, but we often cling to the values and ways of a dying world. You call us to participate with Jesus in his ongoing ministry, but we often spend ourselves in infinitely lesser activities. Please forgive us. Please tenderly draw us into deeper intimacy with you. Help us to experience more of your amazing love and empower us to live and serve in a joyful, thankful response to your unfathomable love for us. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Since we have been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if, while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? In Jesus, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Listen to your children pray. Oh Lord, send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children pray. Send us love, send us power, send us grace. Lord, listen to your children.
Good morning, and I'm saying especially to our children, but the wonderful thing about small talk, it's not always just for the small ones. And I have a returning friend, my action figure Jesus, and last week when I brought out the action figure Jesus, I did not refer to it as an action figure, but the pastor did, which got the wheels rolling. Action figure. Do you remember in high school, and some of you can go back a little quicker than some of us, there used to be this cheer, and because I stood on the sidelines a lot, I heard those cheers. And one in particular was, action, action, we want action, A-C-T-I-O-N. Well, that little cheer and the idea of the action figure and the idea of the word action, our Lord Jesus, he knew how to spring into action. So he didn't have a cape. But he certainly had special powers. And when I think of Jesus, I think of a man, a Savior who's gentle, who knew when it was time for anger, a time for healing, and a time to wait upon the Lord our God. And it made me think so many times how I needed and the children needed to focus, to simply focus on Jesus, the healing, loving, gentle person. Jesus didn't wear a superhero cape, but he wore a crown of thorns. He was wrapped in a thin cloth called a shroud. He died for our sins, to save us from our sins. This loving, humble, mighty Savior. Well, my friends, action, action. We want action. That was my friend, Jesus. Quite the action that he made for all of us. Then and now and in the future, we need to depend upon the loving action of Jesus Christ in our lives. Amen.
Hands of their Lord. Oh, Peter.
Join me in the prayer of illumination. Prepare our hearts, O God, to accept your world. Silence in us any voice but your own, so that hearing we may obey your will, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Good morning. Today's reading comes from Peter, 1st chapter, verses 13 through 23. Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, "Be holy, because I am holy." Since you call on a Father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear. For you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver and gold, that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him, you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him. And so, your faith and hope are in God. Now that you have purified yourself by obeying the truth, so you have sincere love for each other, love one another deeply from the heart. For you have been born again, not imperishable seed, but an imperishable through the living and enduring word of God.
In today's gospel reading, which we will get to in just a minute, it is the first Easter, the day which Christ rose from the dead, and it's mid to late afternoon. Two men leave Jerusalem and walk to the village of Emmaus. When the two men begin their journey to Emmaus, a journey which would have taken, depending upon the kind of shape they were in, between 2 and 4 hours walking, when they began their journey to Emmaus, none of the male disciples, apart from John, believed that Jesus had been raised from the dead. Just hours before the events recorded in today's passage, women had gone to the tomb. They had not gone to the tomb to greet a risen Lord. They had gone to the tomb to grieve and to put spices on the dead body of their friend. When they reached the tomb, they discovered that the tomb was empty, and angels told them that Jesus had risen from the dead. The women ran from the tomb, and they ran to tell the disciples the good news. But Luke 24:11 says, the disciples did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense. But in response to what sounded like nonsense, Peter and John got up and they ran to the tomb. Both Peter and John looked inside, but the two men reacted differently to what they saw. Luke 24:12 says that Peter looked inside, He saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and Peter went away wondering to himself what had happened. But in John chapter 20, verse 8, we read that John looked in, he saw, and he believed. On several occasions, those of us who've read the Gospels recognize that Jesus predicted his resurrection. In each of the four Gospels, we find at least three recordings of predictions about the resurrection. And we might ask ourselves, how did they not get it? How did the disciples not understand that Jesus was going to be raised from the dead? Well, it had never happened before. As first century Jews, they had an expectation of resurrection. Well, the Sadducees did not, but the Pharisees and from what we know, the populace did believe in a resurrection, but they believed not in individual resurrection, but in a corporate resurrection, a resurrection of all people on the last day. So for Jesus to talk about and being resurrected as an individual wouldn't have made much sense to them because they were awaiting the Daniel chapter 12 resurrection, the resurrection of all people to be judged. And another reason why the disciples perhaps did not expect the resurrection was that they were used to Jesus saying things that they did not understand. When we read the Gospels, we see many times where the disciples misunderstand or are embarrassingly clueless. I like the fact that the disciples whom Jesus chose were not the sharpest tools in the shed. I like that a lot, because if Jesus could work with those people, Jesus can work with these people, you and me. The disciples often found the parables of Jesus very confusing. In fact, they almost never got the parables, and they would come to Jesus often after a parable and say, "Explain that to us," and Jesus would do it. And I think that perhaps the disciples did not expect the resurrection because they thought that this resurrection talk was one of those parables that they didn't understand and they didn't want to ask. Let's turn our attention now to the fascinating encounter between Jesus and two men as they journey from Jerusalem to Emmaus. Please remember, in today's passage, it's still the day on which Jesus rose from the dead, still the first Easter, and at this point, almost everyone still wrongly believes that Jesus is still dead. Hear the word of the Lord. Luke 24:13 and following. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing them. They were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" Jesus asked, "What things?" They replied, "About Jesus of Nazareth. He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, It is now the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but they did not find the body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus. Then Jesus said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself." As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it's nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scripture to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11, the disciples, and those with them assembled together. They were saying, "It's true, the Lord has risen and appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. God's word for us, God's children. Thanks be to God. Grieving over a crucified friend and grieving over crucified hopes. Two men begin the 7-mile walk from Jerusalem to Emmaus. We know very little about these two men. One of them is not named. The other is named Cleopas. But he's named only here in the entire New Testament. Based on John 19:25, it's possible, perhaps likely, but definitely uncertain, that the wife of this man, Cleopas, might have been at the cross during the crucifixion. We know that Cleopas was not one of the 12 disciples, and it's a safe bet that the other man was not one of the 12 disciples, because had he been one of the 12, now the 11, because Judas was already dead, but if he had been one of the 11, we would expect Luke to name that disciple. So in Cleopas and his unnamed friend, we have two men who had obviously spent significant time with Jesus, two men who had listened to him, who in their own words recognized Jesus as being a mighty prophet of God. Cleopas and his friend are heartbroken. They're heartbroken because a mighty prophet had been murdered. They're heartbroken because that mighty prophet had been their friend. And they were heartbroken because, again, in their own words, they had hoped that Jesus was the one who would redeem Israel. That is central to the message I hear for us in today's text. The two men had hoped that Jesus was the one who would redeem Israel. How does that relate to us? Well, Cleopas and his companion were hoping that Jesus would redeem Israel from Roman oppression. But the cross put to death any hope that Jesus would lead a revolution against Rome. Please notice what's happening here. Cleopas and his companion were deeply disappointed, heartbroken, because Jesus did not do what they had hoped. Jesus did not give them the redemption that they had hoped for. The irony is thick, because while Jesus did not give them the redemption that they hoped for, Jesus did give them redemption. He actually had fulfilled their hope, but Jesus had fulfilled their hope in an unexpected way. Jesus did redeem Israel, but rather than redeeming political Israel from Roman oppression, Jesus liberated and redeemed spiritual Israel from sin and from death. Cleopas and his companion had wanted political redemption on earth, but Jesus gave them spiritual, eternal redemption in eternity. Cleopas and companion wanted political freedom, but Jesus gave them salvation and eternal life. My dear Christian friends, Jesus has given us salvation and eternal life. Thanks be to God. But are we ever like Cleopas and his companion? Are we ever heartbroken about our crucified dreams, our crucified hopes? Are we ever disappointed with Jesus? If the crucifixion of our dreams leaves us heartbroken, if we're ever disappointed with Jesus, then it's because, like Cleopas and his companion, we are expecting Jesus to do our agenda. But Jesus is doing the agenda of God the Father. Sometimes we pray for things and we don't get exactly what we prayed for. We might pray for deliverance from financial problems, but God might use those financial problems to teach us to receive from God's loving hand, to teach us humility, or to give others an opportunity to practice Christian generosity. We might pray for a new job or for a move to a different community, but God might keep us where we are and accomplish something important through us. We might pray that a particular person receive healing, but that person might receive instead glory and bliss in heaven, which of course is the ultimate healing that awaits every believer. When we pray for something and it does not happen, we have a choice. We have a choice between disappointment or trust. Disappointment comes when we are so attached to our own desires that, in effect, we reject God's will, God's plan. Disappointment comes when we set our hearts on our desires instead of seeking to discover and do what God desires. When life is hard, when we pray but we do not receive that for which we ask, we can wallow in disappointment or we can trust. We can trust that God loves us. We can trust that God is with us. We can trust all of God's precious promises recorded in His Word. We can trust that God knows what God is doing, even when we do not know what God is doing. And we can trust that God is always working in all things for our greatest good. As humans, we tend to be short-sighted. We tend to focus on the here and the now. God promises us eternal life in a renewed, remade, perfect creation. But we're overly concerned about the short time we spend on this earth. No matter how smart we think we are, we don't know what's best for us, and we don't know what's best for those we love. God knows eternity. God knows everything. God knows what is best, and he's always working toward what is best and bringing it about. When God gives us something other than what we want, we can trust that God knows what God is doing, and what God is doing is good. Please listen to these Holy Spirit-inspired words from Romans 8. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his Son, so that Jesus might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those whom God predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? God, who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord, as it comes to us from Romans 8, thanks be to God. Someday, everything will make sense. Until then, we can trust that God knows what God is doing, and what God is doing is good. And as we trust, we find a peace and a joy that's available no other way. Please pray with me. Great and gracious God, Lord, sometimes, in fact, a lot of the time, we don't know what you're doing. We look around the world and it seems ravaged by so many things, by natural disasters, by illnesses, by evidence of man's inhumanity to man. We see violence. We see pain. And sometimes we don't see your hand among us. Lord, grant us grace to trust beyond sight. Grant us grace to, as Paul says, to live by faith and not by sight. We pray, Lord, for all your people who suffer the various pains of being human in a fallen world. We ask you to help those whose lives have been broken, broken by war, broken by sickness, broken by other humans, or broken simply by discouragement, or by depression, or even by not taking good care of the body that you've given. Lord, pour out grace upon people according to their needs, and help us, Lord, us who bear the name of Christ, to also bear the burdens of others by serving, by sharing, by proclaiming your promises, shining your light, and sharing your love. And as we do help to bear the burdens of others, we fulfill the law of Christ. And we thank you for that privilege. We ask that you would lead the leaders of this world, lead the scientists, and lead us, that we may be the salt and the light which you call us to be. We ask these things in the name of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, praying also the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The earth is the Lord's, and all that is in it, the world and those who live in it.
Thank you.
Please join me in the prayer of thanksgiving and dedication. Almighty and merciful God, you are the source of all that is good. We praise you for your mercies, for your goodness that has created us, your grace that has sustained us, your discipline that has corrected us, your patience that has borne with us, and your love that has redeemed us. Help us to love you and to express our gratitude to you by serving you in joyful obedience and by delighting to do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. It's true. There is power in the precious blood of the Lamb. For we were redeemed. We were redeemed not by silver and gold, but by the precious blood of Jesus Christ, who died in our place and rose to pave the path to paradise for all who trust in him. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. today and forever. Amen.
In the precious